So I came out here into Giant Forest in the autumn of 2014 because we'd been having this really severe drought. And I was convinced that the first place we would see the effects of drought on giant sequoias were in the seedlings. To my surprise, they all looked pretty healthy. And I looked up into a big mature sequoia and I noticed that maybe half of its foliage had died. So pretty quickly, we got a field crew out trying to survey how much foliage dieback there was in giant sequoias across the forest, and realized that's just one piece of the puzzle, and we also really needed to get the physiological information that you can only get by climbing a giant sequoia. Still, the foliage dieback surveys and the physiological work can only cover so much ground. How can you possibly expand this out to the entire landscape? And that's by getting remote sensing. So in the end, we call it the Leaf to Landscape project because it's everything from measurements on little clumps of leaves all the way up to entire landscape measurements from remote sensing.
Giant sequoias are just a really special and iconic species to the park. The park was established for the reason of protecting giant sequoias from timber interests. Even though giant sequoias are a relatively rare component of the forest, they're one that is just extraordinarily important to people. You know, they're majestic, huge trees, the largest trees on earth, beautiful to look at with their red bark and black fire scars. One thing that I've really enjoyed and I think is a really critical part of this project is just the collaborative nature. Working with UC Berkeley, Carnegie Airborne Observatory, US Geological Survey, we've had funding assistance from the US Forest Service and a graduate student from Stanford University. We're all working together, you know, with the National Park Service to make this happen, and each partner brings strengths to the table. And no partner could do this alone.
We took the maps that USGS had created and went out and selected two sites showing signs of high dieback, two sites showing signs of low dieback. Our team from UC Berkeley took the lead on coming out here and doing the final tree selection, and we rigged the trees and got them all ready for sampling.
Wanted to make our measurements at the most severe point in the drought when the trees were the most stressed. We came out at the end of August, early September. Over the course of 2 weeks, we climbed 50 trees twice, once before the sun came up. That provided sort of a baseline of the water status of the trees. And then once in the afternoon, at the midday, when the trees are losing more water and they're more stressed.
The metaphor is that the water in the plant is almost like a rubber band. And the lower the water in the soil and the more pull the atmosphere has on that water, it puts that rubber band under tension.
The measurements that we got in terms of the water status, the leaf chemistry, the leaf morphology, water content, carbon concentrations, could be linked with airborne data.
So we flew over in May, and we flew over again in August. And the kinds of measurements we make are those that tell us about the height and the structure of the canopies, and also about the chemical attributes of the leaves in the canopies. One of the instruments on board our plane has a unique capability of measuring the very subtle changes in reflectance of the foliage in the canopy. So, for example, water content in the canopy. The way that the spectrometer measures the reflectance of solar radiation is very, very sensitive to literally how many water molecules are present.
To actually figure out the exact amounts of the chemicals present in the leaves, we've been doing different destructive analyses to correlate the spectral information and the different wavelength bands with actual chemicals that we've measured in the leaves. That creates a model that we can then use to predict over the whole area that we've collected hyperspectral data, how much water or nitrogen is present in a given pixel of the giant forest.
Making maps of species composition and the physiology and the status of different types of species in the context of drought and climate change is useful to conservation and management because it allows those folks to make tough decisions on where to put extra protection, where to apply tactical management techniques. August 2015, there's a lot of forest in California that looks to be severely drought stressed. And I'm talking about forests that go from oaks all the way up to high elevation forests, conifer forests. And it's in a very patchy mosaic across the state. As you get into the Sierras, you see a repeating pattern of the lower part of the Sierras being the most severely drought stressed. Then it finally tapers off and you see that conditions don't look so drought stressed at the very highest elevations.
Of all the species on the landscape in these lower elevation forests, sequoias did the best. The firs did a lot worse, the pines did a lot worse, the cedars did a lot worse, the oaks are doing a lot worse. The sequoias were the ones that hung in there the best of all the species.
In 2014, when a lot of these trees shed their foliage, that was actually a quite effective mechanism, an adjustment of the tree's leaf area to minimize how much water they're losing to the atmosphere in order to maintain a favorable water status.
So why we think maybe giant sequoia is so resilient to drought may really be embedded to their great longevity. They've been around for millions of years and of course have gone through many episodes of climate-related natural selection.
We're beginning to think that the giant sequoia groves are these little enclaves where, for maybe other reasons, there is just more water and more reliable water, and maybe that's coming from even outside growth boundaries but being channeled through cracks in the granite or something like that. It'll be really interesting to start putting all these pieces together.
Giant sequoia groves in and of themselves could be a climate change refugia, a place on the landscape that is relatively buffered from climate change.
The big question is, are they going to be able to make it through these new kinds of bottlenecks and be able to persist in the ways that they have for millions and millions of years?
Stay with us as we develop the story, as we get both a better answer of what's going on out there and what that might mean for the future.